recorded live.
Hello, this is Michael Adams. Nothing but the truth. It's February 9th, 2015. Once again, we have Tom Fress and York Glissman, and we're going to go over the some more of the characteristics of the Antichrist. But before we start, I have a couple of verses I want to read, and then an article. Ephesians 5, starting in verse 6, let no man deceive you with vain words. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. Rather, reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doeth make manifest is light. And then 2 Timothy chapter 4, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, and make full proof of thy ministry. Now, it turns out that Yahoo.com, usually I start the show off and read some articles on that, but that's hardly any, if any. There's one article buried way, way down in the depths that talks about, the title is called, "The Pope is One of the Most Skilled Politicians on Earth." And then there's another one that talks about the Roman Catholics and their concern with Pope Francis and what he actually stands for, and I put that in the link if any, or information box if anybody wants to read them. But outside of that, everything else was about the Grammys, and, you know, do we really want to talk about that satanic ritual? No, I don't. But let's talk about this. This comes from AmericanCatholic.org. We don't have to talk about it, but let me read it. As a reminder of what will be happening in September. And this is dated Monday, February 9th, 2015. Pope to address Congress, John Boehner announces. Now, for most of us on the show already know about this, but this is for those who will listen to this in the future. Washington, CNS. House Speaker John Boehner, Republican, Ohio, announced February 5th that Pope Francis will address a joint meeting of Congress September the 24th. The pontiff's historic visit would make him the first leader of the Holy See to address a joint meeting of Congress. Boehner said in a statement, adding that he was truly grateful that Pope Francis has accepted our invitation. Boehner noted that in a time of global upheaval, the Holy Father's message. Now, first of all, I'd like to mention a couple things here. This global upheaval comes from this particular organization, and this him saying the Holy Father's message is an offense to me and everyone in this show, for he is not our Holy Father. And this is blasphemy to start out
more with. More than that, he is not holy. He is not the vicar of Christ. He's the vicar of Satan. He's the man of sin, the son of perdition, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist. The Antichrist of the Bible has been invited by the supreme lawmaking authority in this country to come and address and speak to the lawmakers of this country in a joint session of Congress. That ought to make the hair stand on the backs of everyone in this country. But it gets very little recognition other than praise. And anything beyond praise of having the Pope come to speak to our legislative body, it just falls on deaf ears and there's no reaction at all. But the truth is, the Antichrist of the Bible has been invited to speak to a joint session of our legislature, and he has accepted that invitation. And our government is going to roll out once again the red carpet for the man of sin.
Amen, brother. And this is what Boehner said, is that his Holy Father, not ours, his, a message of compassion and human dignity has moved people of all faiths and backgrounds. His teachings, prayers, and even example bring us back to the blessings of simple things and our obligation to one another. Nothing here, did Boehner say, was about Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Next thing, next quote. We look forward to warmly welcoming Pope Francis to our capital and hearing his address on behalf of the American people, he added. Well, is that really the case? Is he really addressing on the behalf of the American people? Well, I'm an American, and I don't want him there, period. So it's ridiculous what's happening here. The statement from the Archdiocese of Washington called it a great honor and a tremendous joy to welcome our Holy Father, blasphemy, gosh, Pope Francis, to the Archdiocese of Washington during his proposed pastoral visit to the United States in September. The statement said the announced visit will be a time of grace for all of us. It also, go ahead, you have a comment?
the chief pedophile protector of the world is going to address a joint session of Congress. And it calls it a moment of grace.
I know. It's so.
How deceived is this world?
I know. It also said that the Archdiocese looks forward to the official announcement of more details of the visit. On January 19th, when Pope was on the plane returning to Rome from his visit to the Philippines, he told reporters that his September trip to the U.S. would take him to Philadelphia, New York, and Washington, where he intends to canonize Blessed Junipero Serra, which, from my little research on them, this man, he was horrendous and responsible for an awful lot of deaths in California during his time there. You can look that up yourself. The next thing is Pope said, the Pope also confirmed that he would visit the United Nations in New York and that he had already announced his participation September 26th and 27th in Philadelphia for the World Meeting of Families. So, as Tom has just pointed out, we are having the Antichrist come and visit us. He's going to be talking about the family. He's going to be visiting our Congress in a joint session, and he's also going to be visiting his political world power, the United Nations. So with that, I would like now to welcome you two gentlemen. And York, how are you doing? You're going to lead this discussion, so how are you, my friend?
I'm quite fine, as I told you, recovering a little bit from yesterday's fellowship that I had with Alan Lamont over a few hours. still some experience than was yesterday evening. But got to know some new brothers there, and that's always interesting. One from France, and We'll see if he gets on this call, because he has problem loading the page, as I had in the beginning. It's always the same.
Ah.
I don't know why this is. This normally happens. Doesn't happen when I'm not on this call, so... I have my suspicions. Anyway, I was looking forward to this, because I guess that our broadcast today will bring an end to this subject that we have covered really in depth, I can say, because this is the tense part of analyzing the different characteristics of Antichrist based on the Bible, the King James Version of 1611, and based on historical facts as they are prophesied in the Bible by Daniel, by John, and by Paul. And all these 26 points that we then will have been covered will actually leave no excuse for anybody who listened to this with an open mind and with ears that can hear and eyes that can see, and meaning reading the text for himself, who the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist is. And if there is still uncertainty in your mind after these broadcasts, then you are probably not spiritually honest to yourself, and not led by the Holy Spirit. And that's something we only can pray for, that he will open your eyes and ears to see this deception. And then you will also understand much better why Michael always, in the beginning of this broadcast, reads from yahoo.com, Catholic-owned media, as it is, and bring us the news on the Pope, and especially the importance of the visit of the Antichrist during the last week of the month of September in 2015. So that's all that I have to say to this. Of course, I want to welcome also Tom Press from Inquisition Update to the reading today. This broadcast would not have been the same without him, and that's why I always very much like to have him on here, because, as I said already earlier, I don't know anybody as lizard as Tom to explain some points even more deep than I or Michael can do than Tom, and that's why I'm very glad to welcome you here, Tom. Welcome.
Nice to be here. Thanks for the invitation, and my apologies to the listeners for interjecting before my introduction, but I just couldn't pass it up.
we appreciate it. They definitely do.
So if there's any noise going on with my microphone, I'd be glad if you tell me. I do everything to keep it quiet. It's a stupid cable that when it moves
right,
it, it's on my jacket, then it makes some noise. I can't help it, you know, because I'm not a statue.
It is rustling right now, so if you could do something, that'd be great.
Right now?
Oh. While you were talking, it was, so.
Yeah, okay. I'm holding the cable now away from the jacket and hope it stays that way. So, not much more that I can do, but as long as my sound comes over loud and clear, that's already something, because we have had broadcasts when it faded also, and that was not my fault.
Sure.
Anyway, when you guys are ready, then I would really like to put us in first gear for tonight, starting on the 25th characteristic of Antichrist that we take from the website remnantofgod.org by Nicholas, from this wonderful page that he made under the section of the Antichrist, characteristics of Antichrist, and you can follow the reading whether online on his website, or you can download the PDF, because he put this whole website, or this the whole web page, let's say, as a PDF file, and you can read along like that. And I read from the PDF because it's easier for me, because the letters are bigger and it's easier for me to read. So, characteristics of Antichrist number 25. The Antichrist presumes authority to tamper with and change God's law. Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, quote, "And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until the time and times and the dividing of time." End quote. Something you want to add here, Tom, right now on Daniel 7:25 about this time, times, and dividing of time?
Yes, for 1,260 literal years, that's 3.5 prophetic years, they were given into his hand. We're talking about the Inquisitions. I'm speaking specifically about the Waldenses and the Albigensians and the Huguenots and the Hussites and all of the slain of the earth. Rome, for 605 years, through the pontificates of 83 successive popes, persecuted the saints of Almighty God with a brutality that would shock the senses of anyone who read the accounts. And I recommend the book, Fox's Book of Martyrs, and The History of the Waldenses by James A. Wiley, and many other works, Protestant works, that have been essentially forgotten. The Pope, or rather the Antichrist, has, for all its history, sought to change times and laws, God's times and God's laws. He thinks to do this, but he can't actually change God's times and laws. He can only deceive the world to accept his timekeeping rather than God's timekeeping. Now, the first instance of it, maybe I'm getting ahead of the discussion here, but we all know, those of us who care about these things, we all know that the papacy changed the reckoning of time. And with that, we got the Julian calendar. It's a solar calendar. God's calendar is a lunar calendar. We mark the weeks, the months, and the seasons by the moon. Every month was marked by a new moon. And so the Pope, or the Antichrist, or the Lucifer worshiper, changed the reckoning of time to a solar calendar. That's the Julian calendar, and then later they found some error on that. It had to do with the, I believe it had to do with the reckoning of which day is Easter, which is also a cult holiday. It's not a holy day at all. It's a man-made day. It goes all the way back to the Tower of Babel, and it precedes Christianity by hundreds and hundreds of years. But nonetheless, out of that slight error in the Julian calendar, we now have the Gregorian calendar. That, too, was a pope who changed the Julian calendar and named it after himself. Now we go by the Gregorian calendar. And also, the papacy has changed God's laws by striking the second commandment, which forbids the making and bowing down and worshiping images and idols, and then splitting the 10th commandment into two to make up the difference. And he seeks to change times by deceiving the whole world into believing that Jesus, our Savior, our Messiah, the 70th week of Daniel, was born on December 25th during the winter solstice instead of in the fall. Again, an attempt to point to a different Messiah. And he's literally meddled. He has fulfilled the prophecy. Let's just put it simply. This marks the papacy as the Antichrist, the one who seeks to change God's times and laws. So I'll just cut it short there and let you continue.
Okay, there's only one little thing that I'd like to add. When you spoke about the Waldenses, there's a very interesting documentary on YouTube that is called Israel of the Alps. And when you just type that into the search engine in YouTube, you will be faced with, I think, three parts of each 15 minutes about the Waldenses and the time they fled into the Alps, northern Italy, Switzerland, that is today, for the 1260 years where the church fled the persecution. It's a very interesting documentary I saw on YouTube once. I can only advise you to look that up. Israel of the Alps, it's called. So I'm going to continue reading now in the article here. This happens to be the most graphic prophetic characteristic to date. This is the ultimate in exposing the Antichrist in Rome. This actually has a lot to do with what the mark of the beast actually is. I have all the information regarding that fact on my Mark of the Beast page on my site when you go into the index of the website of remnantofgod.org. I won't go into the detail here because it is rather involved. There's a reason the Vatican seeks to make the entire Christian world ignore the true Sabbath of the Creator God for their Roman Sunday. But what I want to illustrate here is the fact that they do admit to have been the ones that attempt to make this change. This characteristic of Antichrist is their masterpiece of deception, as well as the Lord's masterpiece of exposure. In the Catechism of the Roman Catholic Church, we see ripped out the second commandment, which forbids image worship, then divided the tenth commandment into two parts, so that they shall still appear to have 10 commandments. This proves they think to change laws, as Daniel put it. The Roman Catholic Church, not Jesus Christ, changed the Sabbath given to creation at creation week from Saturday, the seventh day, to Sunday, the first day. And to top it off, the Roman Catholic Church admits this very fact. Quote, "Of course the Catholic Church claims that the change Saturday Sabbath to Sunday was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical authority in religious things," end quote. Taken from H.F. Thomas, Chancellor of Cardinal Gibbons. And another quote, "Sunday is our mark of authority. The Church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact," end quote. Catholic Record of London, Ontario, September 1, 1923. Quote, "Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change the Church ever did, happened in the first century. The holy day, the Sabbath, was changed from Saturday to Sunday. The day of the Lord was chosen not from any direction noted in the Scriptures, but from the Church's sense of its own power. People who think that the Scriptures should be the sole authority should logically become Seventh-day Adventists and keep Saturday holy," end quote. That's taken from St. Catherine's Church Sentinel, Algonac, Michigan, May 21st, 1995. I just have to add here, we did a broadcast some weeks ago about why didn't the Reformers go all the way, and we discussed the Seventh-day Adventists, and we discussed the behavior of Luther and other Reformers. Why did they not pursue the Sabbath keeping, and what were the consequences of that later in the Council of Trent that was held between 1545 and 1563. And this quote from Archbishop Reggio is still very important in this point. So I do not agree that you should logically become a Seventh-day Adventist, because then you're going to join a church that is founded by Masons and led by Jesuits. So take that with a grain of salt, please. Next quote. "The Catholic Church took the pagan philosophy and made it the buckler of faith against the heathen. She took the pagan Roman pantheon, temple of all the gods, and made it sacred to all the martyrs, so it stands to this day. She took the pagan Sunday and made it the Christian Sunday. She took the pagan Easter and made it the feast we celebrate during this season. The sun was a foremost god with heathendom. The sun has worshippers at his hour in Persia and other lands. Hence, the Church would seem to say, quote, keep that old pagan name, Sunday. It shall remain consecrated, sanctified," end quote. And thus, the pagan Sunday, dedicated to Balder, became the Christian Sunday, sacred to Jesus. That's from William L. Jolia, Paschale Gaudinum, in the Catholic World, 58 March of 1894, page
809. Now, Yerk, may I make a comment here? It's appropriate at this time to remind the listeners.
Your comments are always appropriate, Tom.
That Israel was always punished by God for claiming to be his people, but using the worship of Baal as the worship of God. In other words, mixing the holy with the profane. That's what God charged them with. Mixing the holy, that is, the perfect worship of God, the way he ordained it, mixing that worship with Babylonian worship. And always the Jews were punished by God for treading upon his Sabbath, putting their foot of disrespect upon his Sabbath, the seventh day. Now, how did they profane the Sabbath? By not observing it at all, or observing Sunday right along with it. That was the day venerated to Baal. That was the day venerated to Tammuz and Nimrod. That was the day venerated by the sun god to the sun god Ra in Egypt. And it's a profane day. It's a pagan day. It's Elijah confronted the priests of Baal, and he said, you know, if Baal be God, serve him, and if God be God, serve him. And there was a sacrifice, a challenge was issued. He instructed the priests of Baal to erect an altar and to make a sacrifice, and he likewise made an altar and a sacrifice. And we know the story of the priests of Baal, when the sun was in its strength, in other words, when it was straight up, when their god, the sun god, was in its strength at high noon, when the sun was directly overhead, when it was its most powerful, that's when the priests of Baal began to cut themselves, demanding that their solar deity, their Lucifer, would consume the sacrifice. And nothing happened. Their God failed them because he is no God. Now, that Sunday was dedicated. We have to believe, at least I do. You can challenge me if you like, but I believe all this took place on a Sunday. And the sun god could not consume the sacrifice. And to make it all understandable, the scripture says, and then about the time of the evening oblation, fire came down from heaven and not only consumed Elijah's sacrifice offering on the altar, but it consumed the altar and it consumed all the water that had been dumped on that sacrifice, proving that when the sun was in its weakest, at the setting of the sun, God consumed the sacrifice. And of course, they would not repent of their solar deity, and they were destroyed. And that's the end of the world. That's exactly what's going to happen when Christ comes, when Christ returns. Those Sunday worshipers, those who venerate the sun, who keep the Julian calendar and the Gregorian calendar, and practice this solar worship, this mixing of the holy with the profane, it's called Christianity today, is going to be destroyed. And people think it's a light thing to observe a Sunday as the true worship of Almighty God. But God hasn't had his last word yet, and it's going to come at his second coming. The whole world is going to weep and mourn at their error, of which they will never repent unless God grants them grace and mercy and knowledge. That happened to me. God granted me the ability to understand. God, by his infinite grace, had mercy upon me and showed me the error of Sunday, that it was the exact self-same treading upon God's Sabbath as practiced by the Jews. I find myself guilty of the same sins of Israel, mixing the holy with the profane, and I can never again be deceived about it. You think it doesn't matter to God what day we venerate, or that we could venerate every day? Every day I call holy unto the Lord, but the day of rest is the seventh day, and I rest because he rested, and I rest because he is my God, And this imposter, this Antichrist, whether you call him Julian or Gregory, or whether you call him Pope Francis, he is the Antichrist. He is the deceiver of the whole world. And it is they who boast of transferring the sanctity of God's holy day of rest to Sunday. They make no bones about it. They boast about it. And I think they ought to be exposed, and God's people, whoever they are, should repent of Sunday and seek to rest on God's holy day. Is it his day? Are we his? We rest because he rested. We rest because he is our God. He is the only lawmaker, the only legitimate lawmaker in the whole universe. And no man may change his law, not even if he calls himself the Pope, and especially not the Antichrist of the Bible. It's time for God's people to wake up and smell the coffee. You know, we can all sit back and we can read in the Bible about the sins of Israel and how justified God was to punish them. And we see in his punishments that they perfectly fit the crime. Why is it that we cannot see that we have committed the self-same sins as Israel? Why can we not repent of this? Why do we take Sabbath keepers, true Sabbath keepers, and try to denounce them as a cult? That's just how deceived Christianity is today. And we will be judged just like Israel was judged. The plagues are descending as we speak. Moral depravity, government tyranny. We are in Babylonian captivity, and yet we will not repent. Rome runs this country. The chief pedophile of the world, the Antichrist of the Bible, has been invited by our government to come and speak at a joint session of Congress. How deceived can this country be? If you are out there listening to my voice and you're comprehending even a tenth of what I'm telling you, the hair on the back of your neck should be standing straight out. We are face to face with the wrath of our Almighty God, and we will not repent. Back to you, Yerk.
Amen to that, brother. That was powerful as always. Thank you very much for your alliteration of the Sabbath once again. Still, I have some quotes to go here. The next one comes from Martin J. Scott, Things Catholics Are Asked About, from 1927, page 236. Quote, some non-Catholics object to purgatory because there is no specific mention of it in Scripture. There is no specific mention of the word Sunday in Scripture either. The Sabbath is mentioned, but Sabbath means a keeping of Saturday. Yet, the Christians of almost all denominations worship on Sunday, not on Saturday. The Jews observe Saturday. Nowhere in the Bible is it stated that worship should be changed from Saturday to Sunday. End quote. Quote, it's quite clear that however rigidly or devotedly we may spend Sunday, we are not keeping the Sabbath. The Sabbath was founded on a specific divine command. We can plead no such command for the observance of Sunday. There is not a single line in the New Testament to suggest that we incur any penalty by violating the supposed sanctity of Sunday. End quote. Taken from Dr. R. Dale, The Ten Commandments, page 106 and 107. The next quote comes from Isaac Williams, Plain Sermons in the Catechism, volume 1, page 334 and 336. Quote, and where are we told in the Scriptures that we are to keep the first day at all? We are commanded to keep the seventh, but we are nowhere commanded to keep the first day. The reason why we keep the first day of the week holy instead of the seventh is for the same reason that we observe many other things, not because the Bible, but because the church has enjoined or commanded it. End quote. Next quote is taken from Nicholas Somerville, History of the Christian Church, 3rd edition, 1873, page 415. Quote, the Roman Catholic Church reversed the fourth commandment by doing away with the Sabbath of God's Word and instituting Sunday as a holy day. End quote. Quote, Sunday is a Catholic institution, and its claims to observance can be defended only on Catholic principles. From beginning to end of Scripture, there is not a single passage that warrants the transfer of weekly public worship from the last day to the week to the first day of the week. Taken from Catholic Press, Sydney, Australia, August 1990. So even in our times, right? Question. How prove you that the Church had power to command feasts and holy days? Answer. By the very fact of changing the Sabbath into Sunday, which Protestants allow of, and therefore they fondly contradict themselves by keeping Sunday strictly and keep most other feasts commanded by the same Church. So I'm just going to intervene here, and again I go back referring to the broadcast that we did, Why Didn't the Reformers Go All the Way? And the more that I am reading this here and that you are listening to this here, you will see that the whole broadcast that we did at that time, some weeks ago, and you can look that up, was absolutely legitimate. There was not one wrong word spoken or not one word not being found in the Scripture spoken. And you can rather find this broadcast still, of course, on the page of TalkShoe, and you can also find that on my YouTube channel, Juggler66. I uploaded the video a week or two ago, Why Didn't the Reformers Go All the Way? Enjoy it. Going on reading. Question. Have any other way of proving that the Church has power to institute festivals precept? Answer. Had she not such power, she could not have done that in which all modern religionists agree with her. She could not have substituted the observance of Sunday, the first day of the week, for the observance of Saturday, the seventh day of the week, a change for which there is no scriptural authority. This is taken from Stephen Keenan, A Doctrinal Catechism, page 174. Quote, it was the Catholic Church, by the authority of Jesus Christ, which has transferred this rest to Sunday in remembrance of the resurrection of our Lord. Therefore, the observance of Sunday by the Protestants is an homage they pay, in spite of themselves, to the authority of the Catholic Church. End quote. Monsignor Segur, Plain Talk About Protestantism of Today, page 213. The next quote comes from Henry Gibson, Catechism Made Easy, number 2, 9th edition, volume 1, pages 341 and 342, authoritative quotations on the Sabbath and Sunday. Quote, from this we may understand how great is the authority of the Church in interpreting and or explaining to us the commandments of God, an authority which is acknowledged by the universal practice of the whole Christian world, even to those sects profess to take the Holy Scriptures as their sole rule of faith, since they observe as the day of rest, not the seventh day of the week demanded by the Bible, but the first day, which we know is to be kept holy only from the tradition and teaching of the Catholic Church. End quote. Also, James Cardinal Gibbons had something to say in his book Catholic in the paper Catholic Mirror from December 23, 1893. Quote, reason and sense demand the acceptance of one or the other of these alternatives. Either Protestantism and the keeping holy of Saturday Catholicism Catholicism and the keeping of holy of Sunday. Compromise is impossible. End quote. There you have it.
Now this is proof that even the Roman Catholic Church says that if you are truly Protestant, you observe the seventh day.
They are not proud that they changed it. They are
absolutely
proud all the way, and they do hide it not.
Yes.
They do hide it not.
Now, here's something that's interesting. This common observance of Sunday, the first day of the week, but between the Protestants and the Catholics, they both venerate Sunday. The Protestants never repented of Sunday. This observance, this common observance of Sunday, is the very foundation of this diabolical ecumenical movement that we see today. That, together with the now current belief among Protestants that the papacy is not the Antichrist, that all of the popes in succession from the very first pope to the current pope are not the Antichrist of the Bible, as said the Protestant reformers, but that it's one individual, just one individual that comes at in the middle of a 7-year period of time just before Christ's return. You know, if they believe as they do, as they unanimously do, that the Antichrist is one individual that comes in the 7-year period just prior to Christ's return, then the papacy and all of the popes cannot be the Antichrist. And so the whole Protestant Reformation, which was based on the knowledge, the scriptural and historical proof that the papacy and every pope from beginning to end is the Antichrist of the Bible, they now are accused by the Roman Catholic Church of overthrowing the rightful throne of God on the earth, the papacy. And now, because they believe in a future Antichrist and because they observe the same Sunday Sabbath, the papacy says, you have acquitted yourself. By believing in a former, future Antichrist, you have exonerated your Protestant claim, the very foundation of the Protestant Reformation, that you were wrong about the papacy. The Antichrist cannot be the papacy. You have indicted yourself. I used the word acquitted before. I apologize. I made a mistake. You have indicted yourselves as the overthrowers of the legitimate throne of God on the earth, the papacy, because you have abandoned your Protestant knowledge, your Protestant claim that the popes and all the popes are the Antichrist of the Bible. And now you believe in one Antichrist that comes at the end of time. And not only that, but if you be truly Protestant, then you had to acknowledge that even the veneration of Sunday is Roman Catholic. It's a papal institution. It's a Roman Catholic institution. So, therefore, what grounds do you have to continue this protest against the Roman Catholic Church and against the quote-unquote Holy Father? That's the ecumenical movement. That is the club with which Satan has beaten God's children into pulp. And now they apologize for the Protestant Reformation. They apologize for calling the biblical and historical and prophetic Antichrist the papacy. They apologize for being correct. And because they could never cast out that bitter leaven Sunday from their Protestant lump, it now forms the basis for an ecumenical reunion. The harlot daughters are now perfectly identifiable in the scriptures. They look just like their whorish Romish mother. You can tell from whom they came. The Roman Catholic Church. You know, God gave a feast, a real holy day, a day that God called holy. It was called the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And that was a moral lesson to God's people, to go through their house and clean every speck of leaven out of their homes. Now, we all know that leaven is a type of sin, okay? So what the Feast of Unleavened Bread was to teach the Jews to keep their worship holy and pristine and not cluttered up with the worldly, satanic rituals of Baal, the traditions of men, the traditions of Baal worshipers. They were always, every Feast of Unleavened Bread, they were to consider how they worship God and to make sure that it conformed to the demands of God himself, to keep their beliefs holy, to keep their worship pristine, and not to mix it with the unfruitful works of darkness, not to mix it with Baal worship. We could learn a lot from the Feast of Unleavened Bread today. But the Protestants did not venerate the Feast of Unleavened Bread. They didn't go through their whole house and wipe up every speck of Baal worship that they could find and cast it out of their house. They failed to keep the holy feast of the Lord. And they thought it was okay to leave a little leaven, a little Roman leaven in their Protestant lump. And look what it has grown into today. The very fact that they still venerate the first day of the week, just like the Romans do, is proof that they're not worthy. And they're going to suffer the plagues that are about to come. Read Revelation chapter 18. Read Revelation chapter 17. And if you talk about this issue of the Sabbath with modern-day futurist ecumenical evangelical bellies, they'll attack you and pursue you and persecute you and defame you and ridicule you into submission. I've been under this persecution for over 10 years, but I stand fast. I understand the moral lesson of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and I've cast out Sunday, and I've observed God's holy feast, God's holy rest, the seventh day. What the Protestant reformers failed to do, now is our time to accomplish. If we expect to have God's support, protection, and sustenance, we have to do this or die in the trying. Back to you, York.
It all comes down to this. You cannot serve two masters. Whether you choose God, the God of the Bible, or you choose Rome. But you cannot have it both. Nobody said that serving God was easy. That's why the Roman Catholic Church and the whole system the Jesuits set up where we live in make it so comfortable. It's comfortable. It's comfortable to live a lie. It is much more comfortable to live a lie than to live in the truth and to stand in the truth and to stand for the truth and to defend the truth. It takes nothing to join the crowd, but it takes everything to stand alone. And when you are a Bible-believing Christian and Sabbath keeper and really try to fulfill all of the Ten Commandments, then you will always be attacked. And you will have the feeling that you can't live with that. Well, I experienced that a little bit yesterday night, so that was very interesting. I haven't gone through a little piece of what Tom has been going through the last 15 years on his radio shows. It made me sick. It made me sick to my stomach. Couldn't sleep all night. And I tell you, these words here are the truth. And again, I go back to this broadcast that we had on why didn't the reformers go all the way. There are even more quotes in that that we have here. And you cannot choose which lay you want to obey. When you obey the Ten Commandments, you obey all ten of them. And when you don't obey one of them, you are transgressing the law, and you are transgressing all of them. And the moral law has never changed. Okay, continue reading. Compromise is impossible. Either you keep the Bible Sabbath as a Christian or you keep the Sunday Sabbath as a Catholic. Since there is not a single passage in the Bible that says God changed the Sabbath, and the Bible does say we should, quote, obey God rather than men, unquote, we as Christians should keep the seventh day holy. If we do not, we are graphically stating to all the universe and the creator of it that we choose to obey men rather than the creator of men. And one last quote regarding Rome's arrogance concerning the Sabbath. Rome's challenge, why do Protestants keep Sunday? This is taken from Rome's challenge, page 2. The next two quotes. Quote, the Adventists are the only body of Christians with the Bible as their teacher who could find no warrant in its pages for the change of day from the seventh to the first, hence their appellation Seventh-day Adventists. Their cardinal principle consists in setting apart Saturday for the exclusive worship of God in conformity with the positive command of God himself, repeatedly reiterated in the sacred books of the Old and New Testament. Listen, also in the New Testament. Jesus said, if you love me, you keep my commandments. And that means all ten of them, you evangelic bellies out there. The sacred books of the Old and New Testaments, literally kept by the children of Israel for thousands of years to this day and endorsed by the teaching and practices of the Son of God while on earth. End quote. And the second quote comes from the same Rome's challenges. Quote, it's not yet too late for Protestants to redeem themselves. Will they do it? Will they indeed take the written word only, the scripture alone, as their sole authority and their sole standard? Or will they still hold the indefensible, self-contradictory, and suicidal doctrine and practice of following the authority of the Catholic Church and wear the sign of her authority? Will they keep the Sabbath of the Lord, the seventh day, according to Scripture? Or will they keep the Sunday, according to the tradition of the Catholic Church? End quote. As for the quote-unquote times that was changed by Rome, not only has Rome been instrumental in changing calendars, but when does the date change on your wristwatch? Midnight, right? Biblical time changes, Genesis 1, verse 5, quote, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day, end quote. Rome now declares midnight causes the date to change. For much more info on Rome's admission to changing times and laws, you can go to the index on the webpage remnantofgod.org. You will find more references here. I just want to say this last paragraph that I just read about when does the date actually change? When does the new day begin? That made me aware of the point that the Sabbath, of course, starts Friday night with sunset, and it ends Saturday evening with sunset. Now ask yourself this question. What does the Roman Catholic Church and the Jesuits and all the minions do to take you away of keeping the Saturday holy? all sporting events and entertainment events start Friday night to Saturday night. So, I turn it over to you, Tom.
Yes, I have a comment, and I want to speak to the listeners. Is God the supreme lawgiver of the universe? The almost unanimous answer is yes. Now, if God makes a law and calls it holy, and only God can call any day holy because only He is holy. You comprehend that? Only God can make anything holy. Only God can make me holy. Why? Because only He is holy. You see, a man can't make me holy. A word can't make me holy unless it comes from God. You comprehend that only God is holy and only God can proclaim anything holy? And He claimed His day, Sabbath, to be holy. He hallowed it. Now, if God makes a law, can a man change it? If the all-holy God makes a law, may man change that law? Sinful, fallen, wicked man? The unanimous answer has to be no. If God calls a day holy because only He is holy, and only He can call any day holy, if man changes it, it's not holy, is it? It's not holy. Now, Rome admits that the papacy changed the Sabbath. That admission is not challenged by anyone. Protestant leaders do not challenge that. They understand that the papacy transferred the holiness from God's Sabbath to the first day of the week, and that there's no scriptural authority to do so. If there were anyone on the earth made of flesh and bone who could have changed the Sabbath, it would have been the one who created the first Sabbath, God in the flesh, Jesus. Yet there is not one word that He ever spoke that declared the first day of the week holy. If He had declared any other day but the seventh day holy, He would have done it in a similar fashion that He did when He claimed the Sabbath holy on the seventh day of creation. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the day of the Lord. In it thou shalt not do any work, neither thou, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord created the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and He rested on the seventh day, and He hallowed it. Were there any words like that spoken by God in the flesh about the first day of the week? Because that's what it would take to change the Sabbath from the seventh day to the first day of the week. That's what it would take. Words of the same magnitude, of the same specificity, that He issued the true Sabbath. Can anyone find in the Scripture from beginning to end, Genesis to Revelation, and anything in between, any words of that significance, that authority? Did Jesus call Sunday holy, hallowed, a day of rest? You shall not do any work on that day, neither you, nor your manservant, nor your maidservant, nor your ox, nor your ass, nor your stranger that is within thy gates. Are there any equivalent words like that in the scripture? Anywhere. Was there, God shall do nothing except he reveal it through his servants, the prophets. Go through all the prophets in the law and the prophets, the Old Testament, they call it today, and show me where a prophet of God, the equivalent of Daniel or Jeremiah or Ezekiel, used the words that would indicate that eventually God would change that law. You know what the Bible says? God says, I will not alter a thing that goeth forth from my mouth. Is God a man that he should lie? Is God a man that he should forget? Is God a man that he should change his mind? Make a mistake? But there is a man who calls himself Holy Father. A name that Jesus used one time to describe his Father in heaven. There is a flesh and blood man on this earth that calls himself Holy Father, that openly claims to have changed the Sabbath. Yet it's not one word of it written in the scripture. We've been duped. And we must repent. You think I sound hysterical at this point? You ever stop to think maybe this is a hysterical situation? Who are we going to serve? Where do we draw the line? Israel failed to draw that line. They began to venerate the first day of the week, just like the Baal worshipers, just like all the nations that surrounded them, just like Egypt, just like Babylon, just like Syria, just like Rome today. And the pressure was overwhelming. They wanted to worship just like the rest of the world. They wanted to ecumenically unite with the rest of the world. So they started mixing the holy with the profane. It was all about Sunday. And we've done the same thing. And you say it's no big deal. Tom's getting hysterical over nothing. But the challenge goes forward. Anybody who can find even a hint that God would change the Sabbath or its observance anywhere in the scripture, for God's sakes, have mercy on me and show me that scripture in the Bible. Email me at tom@seawaves.us. tom@seawaves.us. S-E-A-W-A-V-E-S. Have mercy on me and show me the truth from the scriptures. And until then, I'm going to keep God's Sabbath because only it is holy, because only he is holy. Back to you, Yerk.
Thank you, Tom. Something to really let it a little bit to sink in, you know. Your words are so powerful. I have trouble to go back to normal reading afterwards. So I'm going to switch now away from the PDF document that Nicholas made, because there's a 26th characteristic of Antichrist that can only be found on the website remnantofgod.org. And for the people who want to read along, I just posted the link of that 26th characteristic in the chat box, so you can follow the reading. It's a short one, and then we will have a conclusion of, I guess, all the broadcasts that we did on this. And the last characteristic is called, the Antichrist will use drugs on the masses to control them. Well, before even reading this, how many examples have we had that the Antichrist will use drugs? And I'm just referring to drugs now in the sense of getting high drugs, not drugs like medicine. Just remember the Chinese opium wars. They were founded, financed, and unleashed by the Jesuit order, who are the minions of the Antichrist. And now in the United States of America, you have one state after another legalizing marijuana. Not because of medical reasons, which this is also very good for, but because to get people high, to get people dumbed down even more than they are already. Okay, I'm going to start reading. Revelation chapter 18, verse 23, quote, "And the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee. And the voice of the bridegroom and the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants were the great men of the earth, for by their sorceries were all nations deceived." End quote.
So who is it talking about? No, a candle shall no more be lighted in thee. What church lights candles? Have you ever watched any of the videos on YouTube about the Roman Catholic Church?
Mm-hmm.
Their churches are lighted by candles.
Yeah.
And where is, what church in the world calls marriage a sacrament? And only they have the authority to marry men and women. The Roman Catholic Church. God is going to snuff out the candles of the Roman Catholic Church, and no more will men and women be married in that church. He's talking about the destruction of the Roman Catholic Church. And he also goes right into telling about the merchants of the earth. Guess who controls the merchants of the earth? The Roman Catholic Church.
Yeah.
The merchants of the earth. We're talking about those who trade by sea. You ever noticed a universal product code, the UPC code, on everything you buy? And in any nation you buy it? That ought to tell you something, that there is one governing authority over all trade, over all commerce. It's called the Universal Product Code. Nothing in this world is bought or sold unless it has that UPC code on it. And do you know what universal means? Catholic. Look it up in the dictionary. The Roman Catholic Church starts their little children in catechism, and one of the first lessons they learn, and they are retaught it throughout their entire lives, universal means Catholic, and Catholic means universal. They're one and the same word, just different spelling. And the universal product code confirms to any thinking man that there is one governing authority over all commerce. And it is admitted by the very use of the word universal that it is the Roman Catholic Church. And this is confirmed in the scriptures that Yerk is reading. Start over and read it from the beginning. Know that it is speaking precisely and specifically about the Roman Catholic Church. Go ahead, Yerk.
As you read into this passage, you will find that it is speaking of the Antichrist and his destructive methods upon the people of the world so as to harm as well as control. Notice the word sorceries in this passage and how the word says Antichrist will use it to keep all nations deceived. Now notice, if you will, the definition of the word sorceries as it is found in Strong's Concordance. It says sorcery comes from the word pharmakeia. Pharmakeia, that's Greek word, and where we got our English word pharmacy from. Sorcery and witchcraft. One, the use or the administering of drugs. Well, what does every doctor do? Point two, poisoning. Three, sorcery, magical arts, often found in connection with idolatry and fostered by it. And fourth, it's a matter, the deceptions and seductions of idolatry. And idolatry is also something covered in the second commandment, right? Why are doctors called the gods in white? Interesting, huh? When you see it in this context. The word pharmakeia is where we get the modern word pharmacy today. For literally decades, the Lord has moved me to declare the popes of Rome have been active in using pharmaceutical drugs to better control the people under his rule. I even came across documentation many years later that had evidence that the Vatican was receiving a kickback for every drug sold across the planet. I believe it was around $5 a bottle. But that evidence was mysteriously destroyed, so I never had a way to prove it to scoffers. But now we have the following article. And I'm reading from that article right now that was published in Toronto, Canada. A class action suit is the first of its kind. Quote, a joint media release by the Association of Citizen Prosecutors, ACP, and the International Tribunal into Crimes of Church and State, or the ITCCS, is to be released on Canada Day, July 1st, 2012. It announces the first class action lawsuit in Canadian history to name as co-defendants the Vatican, the Crown of England, Canada and its churches, and big pharmaceutical companies, all of which are accused of crimes against humanity and criminal conspiracy. The lawsuit is brought by Jason Browman of the ACP and Reverend Kevin Arnett of the ITCCS, on behalf of a group of many others. The lawsuits will be explained in detail at a press conference held on the date of filing at the Federal Court Building on Wednesday, July 4th at 1 p.m. Eastern at 180 Queen Street West in Toronto. A copy of the July 1st press statement is attached. Quote, victims of church, state, and big pharma are finally uniting to put an end to their terror, unquote, said Kevin Arnett today. Quote, among other plaintiffs in our class action will be survivors of Canada's genocide against Native people who have never had their day in court. The whitewash is over. More than 50,000 murdered children will finally be confronting Canada and the Catholic, Anglican, and United Church and placing them all on trial. End quote. And there is a telephone number here where you can contact whether Jason Bowman or Kevin Annette. Finally, we have our smoking gun that the Vatican is in fact involved in the manufacturing and distributing of pharmaceutical drugs, just as our Lord's prophecy stated long ago. And this finishes the reading of the 26 characteristics of Antichrist, but I think that Tom surely has something to add to the points that we made right here on the pharmaceuticals, because this is a very deep point, especially when you think about, like I said, doctors call themselves, or they are called gods in white clothes. Come on, Tom.
Yes, the Vatican, the drug trade is a Vatican trade. The drug trade is a Vatican trade. The Vatican benefits from all the drug trade. The Jesuits ran the opium ships. George H.W. Bush was a drug trafficker. He was a Knight of Malta. He served the Pope. He swore a blood oath to defend the Pope. George W. Bush is a drug trafficker. The CIA is the biggest drug trafficker in the world. Our own CIA. They call it the Central Intelligence Agency. You know what I call it? Catholics in Action. The CIA was created by Wild Bill Donovan, a Knight of Malta. Researchers can tell you there have been either six or seven, I can't remember exactly, six or seven Knights of Malta have run the CIA, George H.W. Bush being only one of them. Do you ever wonder why George H.W. Bush's family calls him Poppy? It's an open joke. The entire Bush family wealth comes from the opium trade. And he's a knight of Malta. Rome can admit these things right to your face, and the American people can't perceive it because they're so loyal and patriotic to their government. Oh, yes, they might be a little disturbed by some of the things that George H.W. Bush did or said about the New World Order and one thing and another, but they just can't believe that he works for the Pope. They just can't believe that he would run the drug trade for the Pope through the CIA. And yet, you turn right around and admit, yeah, the CIA is the biggest drug trafficker in the world. This phony war on drugs that the CIA and the FBI, the BATF, and all say they're fighting this war on drugs is a sham. It's a lie. The CIA, the Catholics in Action in Washington, D.C., run by the Knights of Malta, the holy warriors for the Pope, run the drug trafficking.
Yeah, I just want to intervene here for a second. We made a broadcast here on Talk Show and a conversation of Juggler 66 about the power of the Supreme Military Order of Malta, where we cover all these points in a 2 or 3 hour broadcast. So when interested in verifying that, just get that one up, and it's also a video on my channel, Juggler 66, that you can look it up under the name Nothing But the Truth, and the power of the Supreme Military Order of Malta. Go ahead, Tom.
That's right. But it's not just the United States. It's not just the CIA. It's all the governments of the world.
Now, the Knights of Malta are universal.
That's right. They are a global institution.
And they have power in the United Nations and in all these things. They have seats, they have embassies all over the world.
Yeah. And what does the Bible tell us about the Pope? He rules over the kings of the earth. It says that city, that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. That's Revelation chapter 70. What city, that great city, what city do you think it's talking about? Vatican City.
The city on seven hills.
Yeah, the city on seven hills. The one who is a woman that has a golden cup in her hand. She's decked in scarlet and purple. Arrayed in scarlet and purple and decked with gold and silver and precious stones and pearls and is drunk with the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus. And it's called Christianity. And now you know why John said, and when I beheld her, I wondered with great admiration. How is it that a church called Christian could be guilty of the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus? Now you know when John realized what that vision was all about, why he wondered with great admiration. Well, there's no wonder for me anymore. And there shouldn't be any more wonder among the listeners. But you know what the Bible says? The whole world wonders after the beast. And it does. What a hideous reality. We've seen the total devastation. We read in the Bible the total depravity of Israel. How they rebelled against God in every way. How they became essentially Babylonians on God's holy hill. And for that, they were sent into Babylonian captivity. You want to worship like the Babylonians? You want to follow the example of the Babylonians? You want to mix my holy, pristine worship with the traditions of heathen? Then you go to Babylon and do it. Well, in our case, we've invited Babylon to come here and rule with a rod of iron. And that's exactly what they're about to do. And guess who they're going to destroy? Those who read and understand, believe, and teach the scriptures. That's all I have, Jörg.
Okay, thank you, Tom. Now, these were all the 26 characteristics that were found by Nicholas of www.remnantofgod.org in the Bible, who identified without any doubt the characteristics of the Antichrist. And I would like to close this program by reading the introduction that I have read, of course, in part one, but we will redo part one of this readings again from the first 5 points in a little time. But I would really like to read a little bit of this introduction that we have first read to bring back to your understanding what we are basing this on, or what Nicholas bases this whole page that he devoted to it on his website on. We now have the benefit of historic records at our fingertips today. History is behind us. We have proof the prophecies were fulfilled in the exact years, as well in the exact manner the Bible said it would be. As Christians, we now need to take the advantage of these historic records. We need to use the history books to prove these facts so as to share with those that do not believe. It will bless them. It will open eyes. It will fill God's church. It will make heaven that much better to have them there when heaven starts. Before investigating the prophetic symbols that describe the characteristics of Antichrist, we need to understand that the Word of God tells us how to define symbols and prophecy. 2 Peter 1, verse 20 says that, quote, "No prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation," end quote. This is very important.
In other words, Jörg, we don't have to rely on the pastors or the priests to tell us what the Bible says. Is that what you're telling me?
And I'm telling you also that we don't have to rely on the evangelicals who want to discuss us on the Sabbath question or on Daniel's 70th week question when they do that, these futurist liars, because this is all private interpretation that they use and not the biblical interpretation, as you quoted out when you did the wonderful reading of Daniel's fulfilled 70th week by Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago. Absolutely, Tom.
Couldn't have said it better myself.
According to the word, Christians are told not to give your own opinion of what prophetic symbols mean. We must allow the word of God to define its own symbols. And let me really be sure about this one thing. We must allow the word of God to define its own symbols. What is the word of God? The word of God is the Bible. Well, there are so many Bibles out there today that are corrupted by the Jesuits that only the real Word of God, the King James 1611 Authorized Version Bible, is the preserved Word of God in the English language, and no other book defines itself and the symbols as that Bible does. So when you are deceived by reading the NIV, NSV, RSV, I don't know, whatever other Bible that you are reading, beware that you are not reading words, God, but God's word, but man's word. And that does not make sense. That does not define itself. There it will be defined by men what symbols mean, and there it will be defined by men what prophecies mean. And then you fall for the deception. Get your Bible. Get it now, as long as you still can. Our private interpretations are useless. For example, the term many waters in prophecy doesn't mean a large lake or an ocean, and the woman does not mean an actual woman. There are symbolic images hidden in plain sight so as to prevent the wicked from knowing the truth about the times we live in. If they knew it, they would be more effective in their attack against God's remnant people, but much more effective in twisting God's word. So I think I'm going to shut up right now, and if Tom doesn't have to say any closing words, I want to thank everybody who has been on this call today and listened to this, and thanks for everybody who will later listen to this broadcast, whether it's online, whether you download it, or just like me, will make a video out of it in a few months, and you are invited to watch the video on my channel, Juggler66. And, of course, we will do another reading of the first five characteristics of Antichrist. Antichrist destroys three nations after Rome falls. Antichrist receives a seat and authority from Rome. Antichrist has both political and religious power. Antichrist will have his church and state sit on seven hills. And Antichrist is to rule the world for 1260 years. All these 5 points will be dealt with in a later broadcast, later this week or the week next to it. We will see. We'll do that as fast as we can. But we covered all 26 points right now. But there have been some events lately in the latest weeks that convinced me of that the third broadcast is not worth of the title Nothing But the Truth, because there were some errors in it. Thanks to some people who contributed to that show at that time, and that's why we're going to do it all over. So watch out for that. Watch out for our next broadcast. Thank you very much for being here today and listening to the explanation. And when you understand it, if you understood what was taught here today or what was written to you here today, not taught, but written to you, you have the obligation to share this with your friends, with your family, with people that you call your brethren, and even with the unbelieving, to open their eyes to the deception they are living in and make sure Satan does not get another soul that easy by his deception. So by closing down, thank you, Tom, for your contribution. Thank you, Michael, for letting me on. And I leave the closing words to first Tom and then Michael. God bless you all. Bye-bye.
I will close as I always do. Blessings in the one who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease 2,000 years ago. Christ the Messiah, the one Daniel prophesied to close the 70 weeks of Daniel and seal up the vision and the prophecy. Thanks, Michael and Yurk.
Right. So I will read a couple of verses out of Revelations. Revelation 18, 23 and 14. And the light of the candles shall shine no more at all in thee. And the voice of the bridegroom and of the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants were the great men of the earth, for by their sorceries were all the nations deceived. And in her was found the blood of the prophets and of the saints and all that were slain upon the earth. And finally, this is our Revelations 14:12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have faith in Jesus. All right, gentlemen, thank you for the show, and God bless you all. And with that, I guess that's the end of this show. Everyone take care. Bye-bye.